What's up, guys? Joe Bennett here with Derek Oslin, 212 Pro. And today we got a little push day for you. Before I tell you all about the push day, don't forget to hit that little subscribe button and the little thumbs up, beep, boop, beep, whatever the kids are doing these days. But anyway, pretty damn good session. Derek and I are fellow teammates now with Trained by JP Clothing. So one, this was a clothing exchange, but two, figured why the hell not try and get some muscles along the way.
Damn right.
So Derek coming along and doing a push session, some of my typical push day stuff. So there's a couple things we kind of get into a little bit more, kind of the nitty gritty on this one. But kind of a quick run through, starting with an incline converging press. Got the prime piece, but honestly, any incline converging press is great. I like sometimes to start with a machine because it converges, if you have a converging one. And I would just make the slight argument for efficiency with that, where any other press, gonna be a lot of load from the bottom till right about here, but not much at the top. And with a converging piece, you still have load all the way through the range of motion. Not a big deal. There's been a billion times I've started with incline dumbbells, incline barbell, incline Smith, whatever. So again, not saying it's definitively any better than those, but slight argument for efficiency. Two working sets there onto a fly. You guys have seen me do this roller fly a billion times. And slight decline here. So I would like to see between those two exercises, you've pretty much trained the pecs full contractile range. So a lot of efficiency there. We had three working sets there. If I'm gonna add a working set, lots of times I add it to the smaller movements first as opposed to bigger ones. And if you're fancy smancy in the hypertrophy world, you say because there's less systemic hypertrophy. When you say it like that, you have to keep your pinky up when you drink your pre-workout. Ooh, less systemic hypertrophy.
Yeah, you gotta research study words. In front of you while you do it.
Is it local or is it systemic? But anyway, it should be common sense. Big movements are more taxing, smaller movements are less taxing. So again, if I'm gonna add some in there, kind of do it there first because I don't have to worry about too much fatigue. From there, high incline Smith press. I like the Smith because it's stable at this point in time, and I like the high incline. For starting to transition, still getting some of those clavicular fibers, upper pec fibers, and front delts. Mm-hmm. From there, lying cuff lateral raise. Again, just a very efficient lateral raise, heavy at the bottom all the way through the top. If you don't have those cuffs, just a machine, I think, is honestly a little bit more efficient than doing dumbbells. Again, dumbbells aren't bad. You can get some big delts doing them. Again, just more of a matter of efficiency. And then from there, some cables, tricep extensions. Again, why the cables? Just line up easier for most people in the joints. And when I'm training arms twice a week, like I am in this case, I like to have stuff that lines up very well. So that's the only movement we have for triceps because we have a separate arm day in my split right now as well. And then finish with some calves. Pretty much everything, two working sets minus the fly, two working sets on the calves.
Yeah.
And that is it. That is a push day.
It was wonderful. It was wonderful. For the cuff laterals, it was actually my first time doing them. And like Joe explained, you feel the tension the heaviest out of the bottom quarter range of the movement. And that being the first time I did them, he ended up doing a good amount more weight than I did because he trains it all the time. And my
delts are like,
just way stronger than everything.
So
and my delts are like, what the hell's going on? So that was a great movement. I'm actually going to start moving that into my rotation going forward. But a really enjoyable session. I loved training with Joe. It was my first time actually training with him. So it was a great experience. I can't wait for the next one.
Squeeze. Yes.
focus on contract 100% the whole time, you realize that you can keep contracting 100% the whole time all the way into that finish.
Because you have tension throughout the entirety of the
program. Yeah. Guys, so I'm going to demonstrate something here a little bit with Derek. One, because he's nice and lean, which I don't know anything about right now, so you'll be able to see some muscles a little bit better. So one, I'm going to talk about some things I've talked about before, but I'll actually show you where you can actually see some muscle fibers, which is nice. Hopefully pretty clearly see a difference as far as what we're trying to bias on these flies. So he's going to demo away first, where he's going to have his hips further back, you know, not have his ribs up too high, and just doing a little bit of a fly. And what I want you guys paying attention to is look at where his front delt is, look at where his pecs are, and just do basically a couple reps like that. All right, so pay attention, especially to his front delt, see where his pecs are, and start to visualize the plane of these two so you can hopefully see the line of his front delt fibers and some of the line of his pec fibers. And now what I want you to do, Derek, is go ahead and slide your hips forward a little bit more and make your chest up a little bit more, all right? And now we'll just do a couple reps there, nice and slow. So again, notice where his delt is here, fibers of the front delt, and notice where some pec fibers are in this point. And so it should be noted first, what we really changed with that, which I'll get into a little bit more in a minute, is we basically, without changing the plane of the cable or the bench, we made it more of a decline type motion. Let's have you do one more, Derek. Cool, you can set that left side down. I'll grab this and I'll show something here. And so what I want you guys to see there is this is, go ahead and sit back for me, just the exact same position. So basically this is, what is the merit of some decline stuff? So again, people talk about a lot, should I do decline, should I not do decline? I'll talk about the main concern of the reason to maybe not do decline. Just depends on basically your shoulder joint structure. And I literally mean how the humerus sits in the side of your scapula. The end range is there and your joint structure is going to make some limitations at some point. But there are some benefits for sure of decline stuff over just flat or incline stuff. And so when he's, go ahead and slide your hips all the way back to start. So when he's basically like in this position and we're in the bottom of a fly, if you look, you can see the fibers of his front delt. So if we look at the fibers of his front delt, they basically run kind of right this direction, obviously to where they attach over here. And you can see some of his pec fibers, a lot of them, especially the ones that attach to the clavicle, are very close. These mid fibers are running a lot in the same plane. And some of these as lower fibers are actually kind of pointing more down in this direction. So again, you don't have to overcomplicate muscle fibers as far as their main function. If these just pull in a straight line, so imagine I have a string here, that's obviously we got insertion, origin over this direction, and I pull those points together, he's gonna move kind of in this direction. Hopefully that makes sense. You can see this is the center of the muscle belly right here, and so this is the direction they're gonna go. So if I just do flies here, you know, his front delts can do some pretty good work, kind of moving in a similar plane, whereas if his pecs just contract, it's gonna move right along here. So again, the whole thing is, can you get a lot of pecs in this position? Absolutely. But the position of these relative to some of these and relative to the plane of motion are pretty close. So again, it's kind of easier for your delts to take over in this position. Now, if he slides his hips forward, and remember the plane, no matter what, how we have the cable set up is gonna be this direction. If he puts his chest up just a little bit, and now especially too, I'll talk about where he's got a nice neutral hand position, but even if he externally rotated a little bit, now we can see these same front delts basically are going straight this direction. So the center of the muscle belly of the front delt is almost pointing straight to the ceiling. So now if his front delt contracted, this would really look more like this overheady pressy type thing. And now if we go right in line with where we have the cable, which is this plane, we can see now a lot of these lower pec fibers and mid pec fibers are the main things that can pull more right across and plane with the cable. So again, because the resistance is pulling straight in this plane, if we wanted to oppose that, this muscle is doing almost nothing as far as really opposing that direction. These are pulling almost a 90 degree different direction than the cable wants to pull. So all that really means is now we've taken these more out of plane with the line of force, and we put more of these pec fibers in plane with the line of force. So again, comparing just pecs to just front delts, we've got a position now where your pecs are able to do a whole lot more work. And hopefully again with Derek, we can see the fibers here, we can see pec fibers here. So hopefully you can actually pretty clearly see that these are much more in plane in this position. Now, the thing I want you guys to look at, he's in kind of a neutral, what I call neutral grip hand position. This direction would be even a little bit more externally rotated. the concern with declining type stuff. Now imagine if he went into a press. So if he bent his elbow, obviously he'd be going into some sort of inclining press. If we were lying on a bench and he's doing some sort of declining, he'd have to be in this type of position. Mm-hmm. So again, just to have everything kind of lined up, he'd have to be in this much internal rotation, basically to have these pec fibers working in the same plane. And so again, the beauty of flies, now because again, the cable only pulls one direction, he's this internally rotated, we can have his upper arm in the same position just by externally rotating more. Now again, obviously from a press, this doesn't work, but we can straighten the elbow. And now with that much external rotation, we can work in that same plane. So again, the limitation of doing a press basically in the same plane of motion, trying to get to the same fibers, is at some point in time, end range internal rotation is not a great place to be. You're really gonna get to the point where you're kind of, the humerus basically just sits right underneath your acromion, which is kind of the side of the top of your scapula. And sometimes stuff just gets pinched and jammed. And where that happens can be end range internal rotation and end range external rotation. Now the thing to consider here is, some people will say all decline stuff is bad. I'm not saying all decline stuff is bad. There's gonna be varying degrees of it, right? So are we just talking a 30 degree decline, which would take this huge internal rotation, or a 5 degree incline? Everyone's shoulder structure is a little bit different. But again, the simple answer in my opinion is just program flies instead. So if you want some declining type stuff, if you're worried about working in this end range, is that gonna jack up my shoulders? Just straighten the elbow, externally rotate a little bit so you're not near end range internal rotation, end range external rotation, saving that shoulder joint, and still basically moving in the exact same plane, targeting those pec fibers that we want, which again is gonna be basically kind of your mid and lower chest. And hopefully that makes sense too. If you can see where some of his upper chest fibers are, the ones that attach to his clavicle are up here. So again, that plane of motion would have to do this type of thing. And that's when people kind of get a little confused. They say, well, you can't really isolate different parts of the pec. Can't isolate, but again, this is a big difference from this. So obviously when you maybe have almost 70 degrees different range of motion, you can absolutely do some things that will bias these lower parts a lot more than the upper parts. So next time you're doing some flies, just some stuff to mess around with body position as far as where you're putting your body, where you're putting your ribs. And again, consider how that changes where your front and delt falls in plane with the line of force that you're using. And again, that's even exclusive from what your shoulder blades are doing. Don't even think about all that kind of stuff for right now. This is really what spine position are you in, what rib position are you in, and how are you lining that up with the line of force. That's why I had to scoot forward a little bit, because I wanted heavier, closer to 90 at the bottom where you're stronger. And then if it stayed that same weight the whole time, which is your body starting to just perceive, holy fuck, this is heavy. And if it stayed the same weight the whole time, you wouldn't be able to get to the top. Correct. But basically, as obviously as you're coming, that cable's slowly tracking closer and closer to your shoulder joint, so it's less torque. It's technically getting lighter.
Right.
So you get to the point where it's like, oh, fuck. And then I see all the time people will just start to kind of bail as they come to the top, like, oh, I can't get it. But if you actually just stick with that rep, and just that's why I was like, the good thing, like, close your eyes, think wide, and just contract as hard as you can, it slowly just starts to get lighter, 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 matching what you're capable of doing, and normally you can grind to the top. And that's, like, the hallmark with any, like, good profile. It's the same if you, like, set up bands right on, like, a hack or something, or any type of press, where it normally gets light at the top. You know, you see people doing chest or anything, like, close grip stuff. Like, it's so hard from the bottom is normally the sticking point, and then it's just kind of like, pop, ah.
Yeah.
But if it's, like, gets heavier, then people are like, they're like, oh, shit. And they're like, oh, fuck, I got to actually, like, keep contracting the same at the top. It's the same thing if you ever set up bands right, like I said, on a hack or leg press.
Yeah.
It's like people are just used to like, oh, I made it through the hardest part, and they start to kind of actually relax consciously or subconsciously. And then it's like, oh, shit, oh,
shit,
oh, shit.
I still have to keep trying.
Yeah, and that's the obviously the effect that you're looking for. Some more, and if you guys, as always, leave some feedback below, thoughts, questions, concerns. If you're feeling emotional today, your mom's not answering the phone, please leave some hate down there. I'm here to help any way that I can. For all the normal people out there, hope you enjoyed it, hope you learned something, and I will catch you guys next time.
Like and subscribe.